I guess it's time to what? Yeah, let's get it. Yeah, I love it. We are about to have the Yu-Gi-Oh! Panel. I am your your host for this panel. I'm not Shivam. You just had a wonderful panel with the voice of Goku. How about that? How was that? Was it good? 10 out of 10? Yeah, that was a massive crowd. I know my buddy who had that panel was Dr. Applesauce. Did he do a good job?
Yeah,
thumbs up. All right, awesome. We're gonna wait for Erica Schroeder, Dan Green, and Eric Stuart to get ready. This is gonna be an awesome one. So we will not be having a Q&A for this particular panel because of how limited we are in terms of time. And I want you guys to get the satisfaction of being able to hear them speak and getting everything out of the way. So this is gonna be an awesome one. And again, what time is it? It's time to
duel.
Let's get it. Yes. Round of applause. Again, one more time. You guys have to make it really, really loud for them to come out. Okay? It's time to
duel.
It's time to
duel.
All right. Let's get it. They'll come out whenever they're ready.
Eric Stuart!
What's up, guys?
Good to see you, man.
Good to see you, too.
Thank you.
We just happened
to be in the neighborhood, and you guys are here, too. What a coincidence.
Is everybody having a great time at Collecticon?
Excellent.
You can thank Kybacorp for that.
love it. So, last time I had you on my panel in Dallas, you said I was a third-rate duelist. So for those guys who don't know who this is, that's Eric Stuart, the voice of Seto Kaiba.
Yeah.
And then we have Dan Green, the voice of who?
Yugi and Yami Yugi, or Atem, or the Pharaoh, and everyone else.
Yeah. So, guys, I know that you guys are well-known for being the voices of a generation, on generations to come. I want to know what new projects you guys are working on, because we had Yu-Gi-Oh!, but we want to know what's next.
Thank you for asking that, and actually we're very psyched because we've been working on this podcast called The Heart of the Cards, a phrase you might have heard before.
Yeah.
And we were going to release it next week, but because of the sudden and tragic passing of Kazuki Takahashi,
yes,
we felt that our very first episode needed to address that. So on the 31st of this month, that episode will be released. We will be discussing how Takahashi's contribution has affected our lives in more ways than just having a job for a while. And we will also have similar testimonials from other members of the original cast. And on my Twitter account, which is at Dan Green Voices, so many of my followers contributed their stories about how playing the game or watching the show helped them create relationships that they value to this day, or helped them through difficult times, or simply was just a source of fun for them. So we're really excited to be able to share that with everybody. But we already have like 10 episodes recorded.
Wow.
And the structure of it is, we're using, has anybody heard of Joseph Campbell, The Hero's Journey? Has anybody ever heard of that? Right.
Oh, nice.
So anybody, it's basically just recognizing that we...
One second.
What's up?
I didn't say
that. Oh, okay. So, it's probably nothing. Basically, it's a way of talking about how we all... Hey, there's Erica.
There's Erica.
I'm so sorry. My handler thought, you want me to sit next to you? That it was later. But no worries. How is everybody?
We're doing great.
I didn't stand you up.
I was just finishing the thought that we're doing this discussion. The hero's journey applies to anybody's life. We're talking about things that everybody can understand. And the tagline for the show is it's a conversation about creativity, inspiration, and dealing with what you're dealt, which is just another way of saying we all have things we want to do and all the things that get in the way. So join our conversation. It's on YouTube, Andromeda Productions, The Heart of the Cards, August 31st. So that's one show that we're doing.
Nicely said.
Yeah. We just got Erica Schroeder on stage. Everyone give a round of applause to Erica Schroeder.
Hi, guys. How are you?
I don't think that's loud enough. Let's... Come on! Let's go. It was amazing. We're here. We're in California, Galacticon. Yeah, so what other new projects are you working on? Is that just it?
Well, the other cool project, and even though Dan plays this heroic character all the time, he's also a very self-effacing gentleman and probably will not brag about himself as much as I will. Dan and I, was it 2 years ago maybe? Three?
Longer.
So we've always been talking about the things that we want to do, right? Because we work on a lot of other people's projects and we're like, you know, there's some great original ideas, especially in Dan's head. And he created a show called Crossing the Gods. It is an original show. It is what we call an illustrated audio drama. What does that mean? Imagine reading a black and white retro style comic book while listening to an audio book with some of your favorite voice actors that you grew up with. But not doing cartoony characters, much more reality based, somewhere between sci-fi and superheroes and things like that, that Dan created and also directed and hand draws the art. So what you probably didn't know is what a talented artist Dan is, as well as a voice actor. So check that out. That's something that we are still finishing up. They're short episodes. We've recorded about 26 episodes. They star, of course, Eric Schroeder is in there. We're in there. Veronica Taylor is in there. Wayne Grayson.
Greg Abbey, Mark Thompson.
Yeah, so many of the people that you know from all of the shows.
Lisa Ortiz.
Yeah.
Tara.
But yeah, Tara Sands. But it's a very, very cool project, and it's also just a way for us to be able to show you some of the other things that we love to do, drawing and writing and directing, and getting a chance to work on an original project with some very talented people.
It's
and
so my tagline good. It's so for compelling. The,
my, and my Erica's tagline, husband is doing the music.
Yeah, yeah.
My husband, Kenneth Gackmar, is doing the music, and it's been so fun watching him discover the themes for each of the characters.
And my tagline for the concept of the show is, because all of these characters have superpowers, right? But they also a lot of them also have issues, have real life issues that they're dealing with.
As we all do.
Right? So my tagline for it is, you have to be able to save yourself before you can save others. So it's a way that we can show how these people are dealing with that stuff. All sort of tied into, even with Heart of the Cards, it's that kind
of... Oh yeah, it's a very similar frame of mind. Yeah.
We'd love to be able to share this with you, and thank you for letting us talk about this on a Yu-Gi-Oh! Panel.
Yeah.
But just so you see that there's more dimension than the two-dimensional art you might know us from.
Well said.
Yes,
well
thank
said.
You.
Yeah. And everyone that has been recorded, they all sound fantastic.
Yeah.
I've been sitting on these recordings for years, and I just can't wait to share them with everybody.
But thank
the visuals
you.
Take a long time.
Absolutely. But, Erica, are you working on anything new?
I'm working on Dan and Eric's project, of course. But I'm always working on something new. Most of us are usually working on 5 to 10 projects at the same time. Diablo Immortal just came out. That was exciting. I loved working on that. And I have this series that's running in Canada and in Europe. It's called Boy, Girl, Dog, Cat, Mouse, Cheese. Try saying that 5 times fast. It took me like 6 months to learn how to say the title. But anyway, it's one of the favorite projects I've ever worked on. I play two of the main characters, Cheese and Cat, and we're about to start recording season 3, and I just love voicing those characters. That's just one little thing that that I'll highlight. And then suppose a kid from the last Dungeon Boonies moved to a starter town. Basically, I'm just doing all animes and all projects that have really long, difficult titles to say.
That's like what you look for.
That's what I
love the
for
fact that Cheese has a voice. I was hoping that Cheese had a
Cheese
voice.
Cheese is an anthropomorphic. Yeah.
If I may, I won't break any NDAs, but Erica recently directed me in a video game, and she's such a wonderful director.
I should be promoting that, shouldn't I?
Well, I'm not sure if you're allowed to.
Yes.
But
yes.
Erica's also a wonderful director. So.
It just came out on the 18th, whenever that was, the demo on Steam. It's called The Lost Weld. And Dan and I are both in it. You should definitely check it out. I think it's free to download right now. We're just looking for the funding to do the full project. And it's an all-female team, which is exciting. Female producer.
Wow, Dan, I didn't realize you had that range.
It's amazing. Well, you know, people ask me about Yu-Gi-Oh! And how I do Yugi's voice.
Yes.
My standard joke was I have removable testicles.
That's right.
But then I realized that having removable testicles isn't so hard. Being able to put them back.
That's the crux of it.
You thought this was a children's show that we're talking about.
Yeah, oh, I think everyone's grown up enough here. It's okay.
Yeah, but it's a really cool project, and Mama Makes Games, that's the name of the woman on Instagram who created it. She's a solo game developer, and she's really amazing.
She's
and
great.
I'm also on Instagram, Erica Schroeder VA, and I have a Facebook fan page too. I am not on the Twitter, because that's a dark place. Anyway, but you can find me on Instagram.
And like a shadow realm.
All that jazz.
All right.
Now that Dan's on there, it's even darker. Just kidding.
Well, when I got onto Twitter, I was like, do I have to be mean to people? That's really not my thing. So I'm just doing it the way I want to do it.
All his stuff is amazing. I don't know if you guys have seen it yet, but he's just on there showing all of his art, and it's fantastic. I love it.
Yeah, definitely check it out. I know Eric over here has these quick, snappy tidbits over here that I find hilarious. I hope you guys are enjoying that. I do want to ask if you guys...
Yeah, I do want to ask
a few questions to you guys. How crazy is it that there are full-blown conventions based on just some of the anime and a lot of the shows that you guys have voiced? Like, how crazy is that for you guys?
Well, I mean, I'm very humbled that at least two of the shows that I'm known for working on are two of the most famous, you know, anime shows of all time. And that's just luck, right? Because there's so many things that we've worked on that never turn into things like that. When the fans say things to me like, you're the voice of my childhood, but you probably hear that all the time, I say, look, I never get tired of it. That's one of the most flattering things. It's only the good parts too. I blame the other stuff on your brother. But yeah, it's just it's pretty amazing to me. But there is a formula to it. Both Pokemon and Yu-Gi-Oh! To me have characters that are all redeemed. There's something redeemable about all of them. The good guys and the bad, the villains, the rivals. And I think that's what people connect to. And there's a moral to the story. It's not preachy, it's not hitting you over the head. And I think people also connect to that as well.
And there's a game, trading card game, you know?
That's great for the collecting side of it, but I think the core is...
Well, not just the collecting part, but the play, right?
Yeah, and that does bring people together, but I for the show part,
right.
The thing that first brought everyone in,
absolutely.
I think that it's truly the writing, the characters, the message that was there, whether you like the silly bad guys or the hero, whatever it was, everything about those characters, there's something about them that you could connect to. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, I think it's amazing that there are conventions that revolve around that. I see a giant Squirtle sitting out in the audience there. I mean, I have my own fandom, and I also have, I have all of this stuff at home. If you saw how many Squirtles I have sitting in the guest room in my house, it's like, you may stay in the Squirtle room, right?
Did you want to speak to that at all?
Oh, no, I was just going to say, I mean, what's amazing also, like, beyond what Eric said, which is incredible, the characters that you can relate to, is that they created a way for people to communicate. And sometimes people who have difficulty communicating through words, you know, learn through playing the card game. You know, we've had people come to us that have had communication issues connecting with people, that have found the game, either Pokemon or Yu-Gi-Oh, and suddenly they have a whole community and they have friendships. And they've come out of their shell, and they've been able to sort of express more. And that's one of the beautiful things that we've experienced, is to see those people say how much it changed their lives and how much it opened them up. And because they wanted to play so desperately, it's like, you know, they took a chance and came out of their shell just to play the game. And I think that's an incredible thing.
That is a wonderful story. We hear stories like that often. And another thing, people will say, I was going through such a hard time, or I was thinking about, you know, suicidal ideation, or I was really up my wit's end. And they say things to us like, thank you for helping me through that. And I receive that, and I try to be as gracious as I can, but I also make a point to reflect back to them, you found something in the show. You got yourself through those hard times. Right? And it's great that the show was able to help you from maybe making the worst decisions. but that strength was ultimately found in you by yourself, and you made the change.
Absolutely.
It's humbling.
Yeah.
Beautifully said.
And we've actually made our friendships through those shows.
It's true. It's well, I wouldn't say we're friends.
That's ES, Eric Stuart ES, and I'm the other ES.
Yes.
And that's how we sign our emails and text messages to each other. The other ES.
So, like, with you guys that have been on Yu-Gi-Oh, I'm going to ask a question. It's a selfish question because I am a huge, huge Yu-Gi-Oh fan. I'm also a Pokemon fan, but Yu-Gi-Oh was something that I actually played very, very heavily.
Can you teach me?
Yes, let's do it.
I don't know how to play.
We can actually make it. Like, I have a podcast too. We can actually play.
All
right.
Be careful what you wish for, Dan.
Yeah, I'd love to teach you how to play, but I don't know all the newer stuff. I know all the older stuff. So it's pretty simple. But no, what means a lot to me as a huge, huge fan of a lot of the stuff that you've directed as far as shows go, or just the actual show of Yu-Gi-Oh itself. There was a lot of things about friendship that was super important in there, and it's so cool to see how close you guys are.
Right.
You know, the fact that you guys have a group chat going on.
Does it ruin the mystique that we're very, very close friends?
No, not at all. Not at all. Because, like, in the show, Yugi and
but
Kaiba...
But in the show, that's it, right? Yeah. Is that we are not enemies. We are rivals.
Exactly.
But we also, if there is a common enemy, we team up.
Yeah.
That's right.
Right?
That's right.
Yeah.
So, kind of beautiful. I want to share that our kids love each other. Our kids have a very close relationship. And they spend a lot of time together. And that's a beautiful thing. Because he didn't meet my husband till, 5 years ago?
That's right, yeah.
Which is crazy. And then you guys were born on the exact same day. So they were like, you know, thick as thieves, like these two, from right away. It's sweet.
It is.
No, that's actually really cool. Do your kids actually play Pokemon or Yu-Gi-Oh?
We can't really build the mythology out that far, but they do like to play with each other.
Yeah. Okay.
And one of my kids is getting really into anime. I don't know how that happened.
We just talked about this yesterday. Your daughter and my son are obsessed with anime.
Yeah.
And my son does play Yu-Gi-Oh.
That is cool.
He does not tell people who his mother is. I'm shocked, you know? Wouldn't you want to play that card? But he doesn't. He just like, Mom, I want to earn this on my own.
Just wait. My daughters are 19 and 23, and when we were growing up, I had an office filled with all the swag from all the shows. And when my older daughter was about 13, this is what she would do. She'd bring a friend over, and they'd come and they'd walk through the house and they'd do the whole tour, and she'd open my office door, and her friend would go, why does your dad have all this Pokemon and Yu-Gi-Oh stuff? And this is how my daughter would answer. He does all the voices. Let's go to my room and listen to music. And that's all we got, right? And then she got to college. And she wanted to make some new friends. So she walked down the hall, and there are a bunch of people hanging out in this one dorm room. And this one new student has a display of Pokemon stuff on the shelf. And she was like, hey, you know, my dad is the voices of these, and they were like, what? And then it was like instant friends. And I said, now you have discovered the true power of Pokemon.
Yes. Well, I guess she knew which card to play.
That's right.
That's absolutely fascinating, because like, it, the influence that you guys have, the impact that you guys have, not only like hits us, but it also translates to the upbringing of your children, which I think is absolutely awesome. It's always cool to see a huge crowd here every single time just for you guys. What's the most fun thing that you've done at a Collecticon?
I have to say this. I mean, we haven't been on stage together. It was only one other time we were on a stage together, the three of us.
Oh,
that was in 2012, 2013?
Yeah, that's right. In Rhode Island. Yeah.
I would have to say that the coolest thing for me is anytime a fan has done original art and has given me something that shows that they took the time, and some of these things are like really intricate drawings or even little, I got a great little pin today of Kaiba that was handmade, a little Blue Eyes White Dragon, and that's just real, to me, like it's cool, the merchandise is all great, but when someone takes the time to make something themselves and is creative and then wants to share, That to me is the most special thing about an event like this. We've spent so many of the last two years not being able to be around each other.
Absolutely.
And I miss this. You know, it's great to see my friends, but it's also like this to me is like, good, we're getting back to some normalcy, and I get to interact with some very creative and cool people.
Yeah, it's absolutely fantastic the way you guys connect with, you know, this absurd line, and you guys are able to take the time to talk to people time and time again. And mind you guys.
Well, that's their time. I mean, when you've seen me here, and I really appreciate that, I know that we have to move things along so that everybody gets a chance to see us, but I hope you've seen that we understand that that's your time. That's your, you know, you might ask me the same question that 20 other people have asked me, but you don't know that. And this is what you were waiting to ask me. And
absolutely.
I think if anybody is an actor wanting to do these types of events, they also have to be a fan of something to understand the dynamic.
Absolutely.
It's not just sitting here and signing. It does mean something, at least for me personally, every time I get to see you, and especially if you've done some fun cosplay or whatever, that means a lot.
Right.
You know, it's a great experience to be able to see so many people that love quirky, cool things like we do.
Yeah, sure. And just the energy of the people, yeah. I think it's really hard to pin like one specific thing. And I love when cosplayers go for it, just you see the enthusiasm and the passion. It doesn't have to be something that I'm, you know, related to in the work at all. I think that stuff is magical. And just seeing the joy that people, you know, have when they come to something, they embrace their passions, they're sharing their passions with each other. There's an experience of camaraderie and it's really uplifting. And again, it doesn't have to necessarily do anything with me or Yugi or at all. It's a great atmosphere to be in.
I want to just do one quick thing.
Yeah, go ahead.
Can we get a quick shout out to the Collecticon people and the staff and everybody who is working hard?
Let's give a round of applause to Collecticon.
This is a first year convention tour that is this successful. And for me, I love the fact that I get to work with the same people each time.
Yeah.
It really becomes one big traveling show,
it's a
family.
Yeah.
So, you know, when you see these people working hard and putting this all together, just remember, you know, thank them for this. They put this all together for you, okay?
Not easy to do.
And they're treating us wonderfully, I have to say.
Yeah.
Which is wonderful.
And what I like is the fact that it's regional. So like, it's not like one location where everyone has to go to. And it becomes so hard to get to people. It's giving enough respect to you guys, the audience, to be able to come out and come over here and be able to see them. And if you're such a huge fan that you're able to see them multiple times while you're traveling with this crazy circus.
Yeah.
So we really do appreciate you guys. Like, you guys have no idea. Something I do want to ask is that I know I already asked you guys if you guys collected, but Dan Green, do you collect? And what do you collect?
I have always loved action figures, right?
Same.
Okay. So I don't go for the deluxe Hot Toys stuff. I feel like that's, I just break it, like, rip, you know, out of the box. But one of the last things I posted on Twitter was my customization of Rey. I did my own version of Star Wars Episode 9. And if you guys love what was released in the theaters, I love that you love that. But I wanted something a little different. So I made a whole treatment and a premise. In that premise, Rey, you know how, like, you know, Luke gets his hand cut off, spoilers. But so I had Rey get her legs cut off, but it was because she was taking out the Knights of Ren. In my premise, the Knights of Ren actually did things. So I customized the Rey action figure and put it up there. And then in terms of collectibles, that is probably what I'm most guilty of. I have dozens of action figures.
And Dan has left action figures at my house at least two or three times. He brings them over when he gets new ones to show me and the kids. And then sometimes his action figures become the star of my kitchen table for like 2 weeks until we see each other again.
And she pretty loves funny. It.
Don't you also collect comics?
She loves it.
Oh, well, I comics.
There's a comic book collector.
Oh, yeah. But actually, but comic books, I mean, that's just, I forgot to mention it because it's such a, you know, part of my being. But
yes.
So that sort of thing. Yeah, I'm a huge geek. Yeah.
No, it's really cool to know that I'm a collector, so when I hear you guys talk about collecting, that resonates with me in a way. I want to kind of give you guys time to talk about your careers a little bit. So
sure.
You guys have been voice actors for so long, and it shows that you guys love your careers. And often at times, people go through burnouts or stress. How do you, like, if you guys could give people advice here about doing stuff that you love, and then how do you stay with it? How do you go about doing stuff that like, for example, careers that did not exist that now exist? Like, some people say that you can't make a career out of playing video games. Now you can make money playing video games, or like voice acting. I would love for you guys to take the time to actually give, you know, some words of wisdom, some advice to, you know, people of young age and
right.
old of different right. ages.
Sure.
Do you want to go around the room like that?
Yeah, sure.
I'll try to keep it as brief as I can, but you guys know I like to talk. I definitely have learned in my life, even from an early age, that you can't be told you can't do something, okay? If you work hard at doing it, you have a chance of getting there. It doesn't mean things are promised, but it also means you don't want to have any regrets. But for me, what if are the worst two words to any person in their life. What if I had done that? Because if everybody who was an actor, an artist, a musician, in the creative world, whatever your passion is, said, oh, there's too many people doing that, it's too competitive, I'm gonna do something different. And then at the end of your life you say, ah, what if I had really tried to do what I loved? Because the worst thing is, if you don't get to that pot of gold, you could do something else, but at least you tried it. And I've learned for myself that the journey to me is success. I love what I do, even when I might complain about a difficult session or the craziness of a schedule. I love what I do, and I work hard at what I do. But I also didn't know I was gonna do this necessarily. I was a musician first. I love being an entertainer. I worked in a recording studio that taught me about voiceovers. This then made sense. What a weird thing to do for a living. I love it. It has defined what my career is. You guys know me from that stuff. I would never have known if I didn't say, I'm going to try this. So my words of advice are, when someone tells you, you know what? I know you draw great and there's some fantastic art you do, but there are too many artists out there. Go do something else. Fine. Go study in school, learn the other things that are necessary, but don't stop drawing. And don't stop talking to each other at these kinds of events, because there are so many creative people here. You might find a production team, someone who writes, someone who draws, someone who composes music. This is like-minded people. Just follow your passion. Life is way too short to say, what if? That's my advice, all right?
Well, going off of what Eric said a little bit, this is something that I like to take the time to say, because I think it's important what he just said, so important. So I like to talk to the parents. Anybody here is going to be a parent or is currently a parent, do me a favor and trust your child when they say what they want to do. Try your hardest not to say, what is your backup plan? Because they don't need one. If you support them in what their dream is, they will not need a backup plan. My parents were not performers. They were not in showbiz. They had no idea what their daughter wanted to do, but they trusted me, because I told them with passion from the time I could speak what I was going to do, and all I needed was them to say, yes, you can do that. So I encourage you to trust them. And the other thing, it's interesting, we're talking about longevity and burnout and stuff. Eric and I have a similar history in that we are both singers and musicians. Dan and I have a similar history in that we both were Broadway actors first. So it's like your journey can go from here to here to here to here. One of the hardest things to do is to keep all of the balls in the air. But what you don't realize is some of them can be up here and some of them can be down here, and that's okay. You just have to kind of keep them all moving so they don't fall. And it's a really difficult thing, and one of the things that we've all struggled with but also excelled at is time management. I know it sounds crazy, but if you write down and you make time for things, like you guys making time to collaborate together, you'd be amazed at what you can accomplish. So,
very true.
Yeah.
Great, great, great observation. Yes. Everything that they're saying resonates completely as true to my own experience. When I started getting into acting, it was in my teen years, and I was such a train wreck. When I went to school, I was describing this to one of my sisters, that, oh, it's so brave that these young kids make the choice to go pursue that thing. And that's true, I think, for a lot of them. But for also a lot of them, like me, it was like, I'm useless anywhere else. This is like, you know, I'm here by default. But that was the right path for me. And that was definitely an experience of listening to something within myself that I didn't fully understand, but made a way and made a future for myself that I never would have anticipated, and wonderful things unfolded from that, as opposed to like putting a point on the map and saying, I'm going for it. I just followed something and it led me somewhere. And sometimes that's how the journey presents itself to you. And also, when you're on the question of burnout, I definitely had it in me to be an actor, but that was never what I only wanted to be. And so when experiencing burnout, I've described this before to Ken and others, like, well, then I cheat on my main thing, and I'll do some writing, or I'll do some drawing, or I'll shoot some video. But it's still all creative, you know? And that's what matters, keeping your fire alive. I had a lovely conversation with the guy who's helping me run the table, Brian. And his wife is an artist, and he made a completely wonderful, astute observation, is that artists get bored, but that's a good thing.
Yeah.
Because it keeps you hungry, and it keeps you active, and it keeps you engaged. It doesn't mean that you no longer love what you've done before,
Absolutely. But
you want other things, and you want more. And you see a bigger picture, and you want to integrate with that, create with that, and share that.
And one quick thing I just want to add, because that just reminded me of something else. So I'm a big believer that if you have to plug things in, rewire them, of course, I'm not being literal, but sometimes if we're talking about music, if there's 9 things you have to do to start your creative process, you'll make 9 excuses to not do them, right?
Right.
So my wife is very creative as well. She paints, she's a filmmaker, she does a lot of different things and never knows where to start. And so recently, in her studio, I set up different corners. I call them stations. They're the different things she likes to do that are all ready to go based on when she gets up in the morning and walks into that room. So if you can create an environment that is ready to go with your creativity, you will have less excuses to not do it, and you will do it. Right? It is right there in front of you. Look, all my paints are out and they're ready to go. And there's a canvas sitting on the easel. I think I'm going to paint today. Right?
Exactly.
One switch, we're ready to go.
I love that concept.
Right?
Absolutely.
I appreciate that. Thank you for giving, you know, all these people that kind of advice. Since we're going to go ahead and wrap it up, I would love for you guys to kind of plug in again your podcast, Heart of Cards.
Sure. Oh, yes. The Heart of the Cards. It's a drama the productions is what we're called on YouTube. And the Heart of the Cards will be the first show that we release. Crossing the Gods is still in development, but it's definitely going to happen. And that's basically going to be my main focus for the next several years, I assume.
Yep.
But I'm still recording stuff, so there's that as well.
And if you follow Dan on Twitter, because he's much better at it than I am, you'll see updates on what he's working on and some really fun content that he's been posting as well.
Yes, Pop Story. That was fun.
Absolutely. Yeah. And you can also find Erica Schroeder on Instagram at Erica Schroeder.
Erica Schroeder.
Erica Schroeder VA, sorry. Yeah. That's pretty much it.
Yeah.
I want all of us to stand up, and what we're going to do, and I want all of you guys to stand up too. What we're gonna do is I'm gonna say it's time to, and then all of you guys are gonna say duel, okay? So
but you gotta stutter, right?
Yes.
We're just gonna say duel.
Is everyone standing? Everyone ready? Thumbs up if you're ready. All right. So it's time to
duel.
Nice. Thank you guys. Let's go ahead and give a round
of
applause.
Thank you. Better than that. Thank you.
Let's do it again. It's time to
duel!
There we go. Much better.
Yeah.
Thank you guys. Let's go ahead and give a round of applause to Eric Stewart, Dan Green, and Erica Schroeder. Thank you.
much. We now will have the next panel with Dope Breakers, I believe. If I'm not mistaken, Dope Breakers. So
thank you, guys.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Pulling up kids for fun. Running out of justice, rain for the team. Who wasn't afraid?